Welcome to the grand tour of the Awdry Extravaganza, here live from Towyn Station, here in beautiful Wales. And it isn't raining, because it never rains here in Wales, does it?
It drizzled.
Now, I'm here with Luke. Behind the camera is Stuart, the general manager of the Talyllyn. Switching roles briefly.
Yeah.
Because Luke, normally it's you behind the camera.
Usually it is, yeah.
But you're here in front of the camera. Because you...
It's very weird.
It is, isn't it? You're the Awdry expert, frankly, today.
Yeah, just a bit.
Some would say sadly. I don't think sadly at all. I think it's a lovely thing. Luke, I'm going to say this now, is kind of the instigator of this whole event. A bit of a Sodor superfan, I think it's fair to say.
It's all my fault.
It is your fault. but the reason we're doing this today, of course, is, as many of you know, this railway is what inspired Reverend Awdry to create many stories of the Isle of Sodor, right?
Absolutely, yeah. It inspired a whole railway, the Scarlery Railway, and even, you know, some of the lesser known ones like the Mid-Sodor Railway. There's a lot of stories and characters where, you know, this is ground zero for them.
It is, you know. Absolutely. And we have here today some of Awdry's descendants, actually, some of his family. One of his daughters is here. Actually, one of his grandsons.
His grandson, yes.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly, as well. Richard's grandson is here. And we're going to see them tonight in the Q&A we've got tonight at the live do. But what's so lovely about this today is you've got the engines done up as they should be. So this is obviously, this is Sir Handel. This is in real life is who?
Sir Hayden.
Sir Hayden, number three, which is looking rather spiffy, looking rather lovely. Got one of the classic TR faces on the front.
Absolutely.
Of course, you know, it's... a mock-up of the real thing.
Yes.
I mean, it's quite lifelike in some ways, isn't it?
Just a bit.
But it's a lovely atmosphere today, and actually what is so charming about today is the number of people who've been here, different places, different times, different ages, different walks of life too, aren't there?
Absolutely, yeah. It's brilliant to see the draw it has still after all these years.
Absolutely. I'm going to talk upstairs in a minute about the importance of I suppose, the Thomas fandom, right? And the importance of enthusiasm and why Thomas Tank Engine and Scarlery is so important today. But behind us is the beer festival as well going on.
Absolutely essential.
Let's go for a little walk, shall we? We're going to go for a walk up here, because that is Sir Handel. It isn't the only engine we've got here today, of course.
No, that's all.
Up here is another one, an engine of dual identity, right, Luke?
Oh, a little bit, yeah. Yeah, so we've got Renias.
You've got Renias. And Renias, of course, is loco number two, right?
Yes.
And it's Scarlery Railway number two. And on the front of it, you've got Reverend Awdry with his headboard on the front of it.
Yeah, so that was cast in his memory for his birthday centenary celebrations. And it usually lives up in the study in the museum. But we thought it'd be quite appropriate to bring it out today.
Lovely stuff. Know. Lovely. Lovely stuff indeed. Right, as you can see, it's a busy old day down here at the railway, looking rather lovely. Now, we're going to go inside in a minute, and just so you know, this is all done COVID securely and safely. Luke and I have both had our tests done in the past couple of days, both been negative tests, and that's fine. But there are a couple of bits we're going to put our masks on to walk through the museum to get to the top and give you a little chat about Awdry and then show you some of the layouts and some original artwork that Mattel and the team have brought along very kindly from those books. I mean this is amazing, right?
It's brilliant.
This is really nice. And this is your fault. You got them to bring it along. We've got some original artwork to show you live and some of the model railways that Awdry himself built and operated that haven't been seen in public for a long time.
No, so, well, we'll have a little, shall we talk while we walk?
Yeah, let's walk up there. And we'll put our masks on briefly as we go up through it. And then we're going to basically stay apart as far as we can, COVID securely, as much as we can, as we get up to the very top, and then give you a sort of tour around there without a mask on for a short while, just so you can see what we're saying in the environment upstairs. But we'll be able to bring you that as soon as it comes. Now, of course, this, as you can see, actually talking about COVID security, look at this. You've got all this stuff going on. This is great. Look, even your open top wagons. This is wonderful. This is lovely. And you've got the compartments going on as well. I mean, if there was ever an era when railways came into their own, it's the COVID era of those COVID compartments. Brilliant. Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant. Right.
So we've got a mask on.
Mask on for the next bit. Now walk upstairs. Right, after you.
Hello, everyone.
Off we go.
Sorry, we're going to
mega.
Right. Going up through the engine. Look at this. You've got William Finlay upstairs. Keep going.
Keep going.
Right,
Stuart, able to keep up.
It's not great, I know this. It's a bit weird with our faces covered up. We'll take you through as we can.
Hopefully you can still hear us.
Let's kind of stand over here. So.
Right. You can take them off now.
Here we are. Here we are. Up here on the big balcony, right across. Yeah. There's the sea over there, and the mountains over there. We're in that magical kingdom between the mountains and the sea, aren't we?
Oh, absolutely.
Now tell me, look, Luke, you've been involved here for a number of years.
Not as many as most. I'm still relatively young compared.
But please tell us a little bit. Is a reason why? What do the Awdry stories mean to you?
Well, for me, it's always been one of those things where I've grown up with it. My whole life. My mum, who I think is probably watching, has said the first word could have even been Thomas. I blame her for it all. There was a lamp above my cot, which was Thomas, and that's apparent. That's basically ground zero for me. But reading the Scarlery stories, and always at the end, if you've enjoyed these stories, come and visit the Talyllyn Railway and see the real engines. Wilbur always wanted to help the preserved railways in the fleeting years, as they were starting out, and you know, I think it's helped it all the way through their lives.
Yeah, because it's kind of stand over here actually, because this is a nicer backdrop for looking at the playground over there.
Absolutely, yes.
You've got engines moving down.
Oh yes. But yeah, it got me wanting to come to railways and helping out, and I finally got down here, 2016 now. It was the first time I managed to get here.
Yeah.
Next year I was down volunteering.
Brilliant.
Thanks to the wonderful hostel.
And now you're actually working here, aren't you?
Yes.
You're actually being employed since, by the railway.
Since September. That's been very weird, but very brilliant.
It's been
brilliant. Get to use my degree. Ooh.
but look at this though, right? So if you look at this out here, this is exactly as Awdry and his artists he had and the railway series portrayed in those early years of the railway series, right? This is how it looked.
Yeah.
And so these are the engines, these are the trains, these are the carriages, these are the places in some of the books.
Absolutely. Many of the stories you read about the Scarlery engines were based on what he got up to when he was volunteering
of
here.
Of course.
Because he was one of the first he was one of the first members of the society, number 79, so very early on.
Yes.
And he was volunteering in 1952.
Now that famous story about the refreshment ladies being left up at the top station, that's true, isn't it?
That all happened, and it was Wilbur who was guarding it, and that's probably why it's a bit vague in the story as to whose fault it was.
And there's a wonderful story, which is immortalised, I suppose, in that story, Gallant Old Engine, where Rhenius has to make it back down the track, and it's almost, it really is then replicated again 3 years later by the Titfield Thunderbolt.
Yes,
so
absolutely.
The Titfield Thunderbolt is based on a kind of a sober story.
And you've got, obviously, that whole story of Gallant Old Engine, the real account is in Railway Adventure by Tom Rolt. And there's a credit to Tom Rolt in the Gallant Old Engine book as well. So it's all so tied together. It's amazing. And, I mean, from the amount of people you can see here, it's still got a draw.
Absolutely. Now, what is drawing them? Because there is a lovely cross-section of people here today who you wouldn't normally see it, but I would think you might see it at Steam Railway. Often we think it's just, you know, people like me, old men like me, middle-aged people. But it isn't. There are some young people here today.
Yeah. I think it all draws back to childhood and, you know, what you are, you know, the years of comfort, if you know what I mean. You know, it's something you can look back on and enjoy. And I think because it's been going for 75 years, you've got a massive generational crossover there. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a granddad will have read the stories.
Yeah.
And, you know, then their son and their grandson or grandchild or anyone. You know, there's such a cross-section of generations that will have enjoyed them growing up.
Because I love the books when I was a kid. I loved that stuff. They're brilliant fun. I had the little books, the long books.
Yeah. They're
usually about sort of five or six. I'm sure most of you watching did as well. I know Stuart is nodding his head, you know. And Stuart is definitely slightly older than I am. I'm age 40. But there are people here, I think you can describe as the Thomas fandom, right?
Yeah. Where,
and a lot of the people who are younger than me, your age,
And younger,
have this love of the Isle of Sodor. What is it, do you think, that makes it so interesting? What draws people to the Isle of Sodor?
For me personally, it's Wilbert never treated the children he was writing for patronisingly. You know, he always wanted to make sure they were written as they would be for anyone. And I think that's kind of when you... Well, it got me going to Real Railways. And then I took an interest on in Real Railways. And then when I've gone back and read them, I can identify technical terms. And that gives me a deeper appreciation for it. I think that's what keeps people interested, because there's a rich... You think Tolkien, with Lord of the Rings, wrote a lot about the history of his fictional world. So did Wilbert, to rival it.
Yeah.
And that's a lot that keeps people interested. But, like I said, I think for some of it, it's the comfort of it, because it's something... The stories are very quaint, and they're very nice.
And let's be honest, all the stories have a positive end. I mean, I say all of them. I mean, there are a couple. My favourite story... I quite like some of the darkly bleak ones that kind of have sort of undertones. I can't. It's like there's one that I love, which is it's the sad story of Stanley, isn't it?
Mm.
And Stanley is naughty, and he gets his wheels taken off, and he's stuck at the back of one of the sheds, isn't he? He's bricked up, and he uses a pumping engine.
Yeah.
You never hear of Stanley again, do you?
No.
I mean,
he's gone.
I quite like some of that stuff.
I think that's also a part of it,
yeah.
Because there's, you know. It's like part of maturity. In the, not mature, you know what I mean. It's that there are genuine consequences to some things like that.
Actions have consequences.
Yes.
Yeah, quite. But you know what? Most of them are joyful. Most of them are lovely. And they're escapist, right?
Yes.
And they're stories that have got some of the most sort of little morals. Some are just joyful silliness and just sort of, you know, just sort of frippery. And that's quite
Absolutely.
Good fun too. But look, I say, people down there love this stuff. Now, inside here, you talk about how Awdry built a whole world.
Yep.
Behind the whole of the world, the Isle of Sodor. Tonight, in our lecture, which is going to be available, I know, after the event as well. Next week, you're doing a where you can buy the lecture as well, aren't you, I think, as like a single
I think we're still deciding exactly how we're going to go through with it, but the lecture will be available after the live stream tonight. Might be a little while, but it's definitely going to be out there,
yep.
So don't worry.
If you have missed it, don't worry. You can't get tickets for tonight. But what we're doing is we are talking about the Reverend Awdry's history, his backstory. I mean, he wrote a couple of books on this stuff.
Now, this is me as a railway enthusiast side. The way it lines up with real railway history is what really makes me very happy about it, because it all pieces together really nicely with real world history. You know, he doesn't go too insane. He tries to make it line up with the time periods, and it's very satisfying.
He did that. As well as build his own model railways, depicting the engines and the places and the coaches and the people, actually, that he talked about in the stories.
Oh, yeah.
So, and again, we know that he actually made little models, didn't he? The original models of Thomas, you know, the family still have. And you have some of the models that Awdry made in here. We have the 1940s model of Thomas the Tank Engine.
Yeah, 1948.
The actual real one. So, let's go and see those now, right? So we're going to keep our masks off for most of the time in there. We'll put them on for the first bit. We're going to go look at them inside now. So do apologise for the mask, but we're going to just take this off for a minute. Now, staying separate if you can over there. We'll take our mask off for a minute. Luke's over there. Stand over there, Luke, would you mind?
Mm-hmm.
Just fine. So behind us over here, we have got what looks to me to be a 16 mil narrow gauge railway scale, and you've got models here that you guys have all built, right? These are scratch built models. Can you talk us through a couple of these models? Because this one, this is Donald and Douglas. Now, these are scratch built. You've made these, right?
Yes, essentially. The front ends are Backman Thomas's, as you can buy them, and we've scrapped the tops basically,
okay.
And turned them round as well. You see the front buffer beams are a bit deeper than they ought to be, so that's how we did that. And then the rears are Emily tenders that we bought as spares. And essentially everything from the chassis up has been scratch built out of anything, out of drain pipe and sheet plastic and all other nonsense. Edward is a converted James that was also bought commercially and very heavily chopped up.
And so these are G-scale model
trains?
Yes, they're compatible
with what Backman produce, and we've sort of expanded it to a point where they'll never catch up, so that's rather nice.
Look at this one, this is Boko.
This is Boko, and he's very, very good. He's been made completely scratch-built. Everything is made. It's just made of anything we had, spares, plastic, bits of wood, bits of metal, bits of old James, and a completely plastic body.
But if I look at these are not just like the ones that I've seen in the railway series. these have got a family likeness to the stuff that I've seen on the early television programmes, right?
Yes, essentially. And what we've done is sort of marry the two. What we've done is not create prop replicas or create railway series characters. We've taken multiple sources to create interpretations of the characters as opposed to being replicas or anything like that, much as the illustrations are.
Absolutely.
Interpretations.
What a lovely idea.
Thank you very much.
You've taken all the inspiration, different artists that were behind railway series and Thomas series, combined them all and reinterpreted them together.
Yes, and get the essence of the character.
That is terrific, really terrific. But that's the big railway going past. Of course, we're here at Croven's Gate. Is it Croven's Gate here?
Yes,
now? Yeah, so there's the big railway going past Croven's Gate right now. And again, this is lovely. And this looks very much like the Ridirunyan shelter, is it not? Up the line? So that's very good indeed.
Yes, now, I believe that's Kez Jones's father's doing.
Is it really? So this is from the old Compton Down collection, is it?
I believe so.
That is a bit of railway, model railway history there. That's very special indeed. So Kez, who's one of the staff here at the TR, one of the volunteers and paid members of staff, actually her dad ran a model railway called the Compton Down Railway, which was a very famous model railway for generations, actually, well, a couple of generations, and well written about in railway press over the years. Look over here, Luke, over here is something very impressive. This is the Awdry Study. Can we get a key to the Awdry Study, do you think? Can we go inside the Awdry Study somehow? Can we have a key to it?
Who's got a key? Give me 2 minutes.
He's off to go and get a key. Look at the Awdry Study. Now this, you never get a chance to see inside. I'm going to hold this, get a feedback on that. Great. So as the trains go around here, a couple more things to show you. One, through that door over there, is the main exhibition. I'll take them to the second. But first, we're going to go into the Awdry Study. Bit of a low light, but this is a recreation using objects from Awdry's study that the Narrow Gauge Railway Museum team put together, using so many artefacts from Awdry's original location. We've got the keys. We've got the keys. He looks like a jailer. Look at him. He's a jailer. But look, there's stuff here that, you know, we've got models that Awdry built through here. And inside, he's finding the keys still. I mean, this could take a little while. There's only 75 keys on that. That's a pretty good idea, actually, Stuart. Look at something different that isn't me. Can we go in? Right. Look at that. Right. There goes Fred. Right, let's go in. What are you doing? There's your microphone. So, into the Awdry Study.
Here we go.
Let's have a look. Right. Oh, crikey. Now, Luke, let's go stand over here. Look at this. So, this is all rather lovely. There are artefacts in here. If you see in the low light, you can see this. This is his desk, as oh, was, yeah. And his seats, all his books, and they're in here as well. And it's his own personal effects, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, majority of the books that were on the shelves, they were all his. There's a few in there that have been donated to the railway, and we've put them in to bulk it out, but pretty much all of it is his. His desk, his typewriter, we have got documents that were written on that by him.
Yeah.
His glasses, his pipe, his fuzzy hat.
And it's objects here. I've got here a model of Wilbert.
That's a Today edition. That is a prototype of the model that was produced. Because the chap who commissioned it is around today, participating and coming to the event. Made a few years ago as a commercial model.
That's OO gauge, right?
Yes, yeah, and it's the engine that was named after him on the Dean Forest Railway, where Stuart used to do some general managing.
Look at that.
Yeah.
So that's here for just today, is it?
It's now on loan to the museum. So that's on there.
As of today. This is the newest exhibit. This has been
Oh, yes.
Oh, that is a lovely thing. So this is Wilbert. So this is the art.
There's another new thing which has gone on for this week, but we'll have to go outside for that, so we'll have a look at that in a minute.
Okay. Well, this is his study, and there are things here, there are elements. These are his...
Yeah, these are some of his original engines. So this one's not seen very much. And this is the original duck. And that actually inspired the name for the character, because it used to waddle as it went along the line, which is why the character's called Duck.
That is the original duck.
The character is actually called Montague, but then he changed the name to Duck as a nickname.
That's the original. I mean, I probably shouldn't touch that, actually. Through my greasy.
It's a sturdy model.
What's that one?
So that's Henry.
That's got bits missing.
Yeah.
He's got bits missing. What's
so
happened to him?
Reading through some of Wilbert's documents, he was The Henry model gave him a lot of trouble. It was a Graham Farish when they still did 00.
Yes.
It was a Graham Farish model.
Go on, stick it up. Yeah.
Yeah, and the motor ran through the tender. The motor was in the tender, and it ran through a camshaft into the loco to drive the wheels.
Yeah.
So it was horribly inefficient. And Wilbert, well, in an annual, he said he scrapped it. So when we found this, it sent ripples through some people's brains because they thought that was long binned. But he started rebuilding the chassis to put a motor in the engine. And we've decided to keep it like that because it's one of the rare instances of a non-complete model by Wilbert.
That is fabulous. And that is Boko.
That's Boko, yeah.
A Kobo, an ill-fitted metric.
Boko, the Kobo.
Look at that. And again, very heavy engine.
That would have been used for illustrator's reference more than anything, because a lot of his models were used by the painters to get the engines right.
Good Lord. Good Lord. So we are. This genuinely is...
Yeah.
This is where those stories actually began, with these models. I think that is...
It's brilliant.
It's very special. Thank you very much. Well, let's go through now and look at some of the other models and the whole layout. Shall we?
Quick nose out through the window, because there is something brand new.
Yeah, show us one new thing outside.
So we've put a lovely big new sign on the top of the study.
New sign?
And this has gone up for this weekend, and we'll be staying there.
Good.
So it's a lot more proud and... you know, shouting out to you when you get here, and flanking it are the crests for the Scarlery Railway and the Northwestern Railway.
Lovely.
Based on Wilbert's original sketches and descriptions.
Now, I'm going to check that I can be socially distant in that room, so give me a
Absolutely.
Second, back
no
in a
worries.
Moment.
No worries. I'll lock the room while he's doing that.
Yes, we can be socially distant in there, Luke, so we can go through.
Excellent, I will lock the door.
Right, so windows are wide open, we can be socially distant. So we can now, Luke has got the keys and explain to us what we're looking at actually now, because is that Daisy? Is that the Daisy?
Indeed it is.
That is Daisy. So Luke, what is this railway we're looking at now? This is Farquhar Branch.
Yeah, so this is Farquhar Branch, and this was 1968 built. He had a bigger layout. It's the second version of Farquhar.
Okay.
And he rebuilt it into this long and thin version so he could fit it in his car.
Right.
And take it to model railway exhibitions.
That is fab. See, I like Daisy because she wears a lot of makeup.
It's also the best runner on the layout.
She wears a lot of makeup and she is always out on the town. You know, she's going out. She is going out.
Oh, yes.
Out is Daisy.
Oh, yes.
I like that a lot. And you've got over the back over there, look,
you've got Mavis down the back there.
Oh, this is lovely.
So you've got all sorts of bits. These are all the original models for the characters. Mavis, the model, was built about 7 years before she actually appeared in a book.
Good grief.
So
that this stuff really is being built.
Oh, yeah.
As the prototype for all of the books.
The illustrators, again, used it for reference for the location.
That is astonishing.
This section Stuart's showing you on camera now, this is the first time it's been to an exhibition in probably about 10, 12 years. Usually when it's on display in the study, it's just from the level crossing to the end bit. This is seldom seen, so it's quite special to see it out here today.
That is lovely. How lovely. And so, oh, look at that. See, over on the camera now, what can you see now, Luke?
So you've got Donald, one of the Scottish Caledonian engines, Percy, and Toby the tram engine.
Smashing. And so these are all models built from Awdry's own head, and he's taken some kit-bashed things and rebuilt
them. Well, the Toby's completely scratch-built. That was the first model of Toby, 1954, I believe.
Yeah. A gold shell and wheels.
Oh, yeah. The bottom half is brass and top half is balsa wood. So,
terrific.
And it runs really nicely.
Now, you guys that run the railway, I'm going to pick on you.
Oh, hello.
Daniel, I'm going to pick on you because you're the closest one.
Hi.
Now, look, Daniel, you've come along here and look, you've got a thing around your neck. What is this?
This is the original controller, I think, that Awdry used when he built the layout. So he's designed it, it's all goes together, it's very well done, and it has a nice kill switch if anything goes a little bit awry.
Made out of a cigar box.
So it's been running surprisingly well, considering it hasn't run for a very long time. We've been running it since yesterday,
Lovely.
And it hasn't really failed.
Now, you're running this railway, not just how you feel like it, you run it to a sequence, aren't you, you guys? You've got a plan behind everything you're doing.
Right? Oh, no.
This isn't just a joke. This is doing it to plan.
Yeah. There's a very specific sequence. So there's three sequences. They last about 20 minutes. And Awdry's designed it so that when the sequence ends, everything ends up in the right place for the sequence to re-begin again.
Okay.
Exactly the same way.
Okay.
So we're currently at Thomas moving Annie and Clarabelle to the throat.
Okay.
So if he runs.
Where's Thomas?
Thomas is here.
Thomas is down
in the
there.
Quarry fiddle yard.
I feel like one of those parents saying, "Where's Thomas?
Yeah.
Where's Thomas?" Because that is a refrain you hear quite a lot, isn't it? Where's Thomas? Where is he? Where's Thomas gone? Right.
Come on.
So
that's
Thomas there.
And this Thomas is the original electric one. It's just the first model that the Reverend ever built. Ever. It still runs. Just about.
That is really the Thomas the Tank Engine.
That's, he's and a bit temperamental, so it's definitely the Thomas the Tank Engine.
Where's he stopped?
Go on.
There he goes. He's a bit old and a bit tired now. So, like the real one, like the one in the books, the friend we know in the books. It's a bit of a temperamental character.
I mean, these aren't just museum pieces, are they? Because you're running them now. And they do actually work.
No, they do.
Ish.
They work very well most of the time.
Except when there's a camera here.
Especially considering their age. But they're a bit camera shy, bless.
Yeah, of course.
Luke, you know the layout. Okay, it's just a shaft. Sometimes it's a shaft, sometimes it's operator's error. I like to check it's not my fault before I blame Thomas. So Thomas is running to the good dock.
The goods dock?
Yes.
Right,
which
okay.
is part of Farquhar Station.
Okay.
So he's held there, and he reverses to the cattle dock.
How do you know this?
Because he wrote it down on these sequence cards.
Oh, he's got sequence cards. So
every single thing that the engines do is written down and handily labelled so that I don't have to worry about remembering it.
I mean, what we're saying is here, a bit of a control element to it, really. You know, he's specifying exactly what's happening, what's going on.
Yes.
If you want to know how deep he got, he drew train timetable graphs, the graph lines for the entire branch line, not just Farquhar. He planned the entire timetable of the whole branch line just so he could figure out what happens here.
Wow.
So he was that in deep.
I mean, I'm using his words tonight for this lecture.
Oh, yes.
Where he does the whole thing. But he did things like, you know, he created the whole backstories of the members of the family, of the great families of the Isle of Sodor.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
It's extraordinary.
Entire family trees.
Naughty Thomas, he's going the wrong way.
He wants the carriages again.
Who would make him do that, eh? Daniel?
He can't part with his cookies.
He's very protective.
Scott, you make excuses now, but really, honestly. Let's move around, I think. Over here.
He's not there.
One more model railway, I'll show you.
Come over here.
This is another model railway. Luke, turn out this one here, because this one hasn't been seen for quite some time.
Yeah. So the Mid-Sodor Railway, or the layout Ulfstead Road, the last time this was seen publicly was around 2004 at the Cadby Light Railway, which was Reverend Teddy Boston's...
His mate.
Or, yeah, his good
yeah.
mate.
Yeah.
Or the fat clergyman in the books. That was at his light railway before it closed.
Wow.
When Wilbert passed, he gave it on to them. And sadly, when Cadby closed, it was returned to the family.
Okay.
And it hasn't been seen since, until today.
Lovely. What a lovely thing. Now, in the background, I can see that there's dedication going on, and there's some slight... The hand of God is going in.
Fiddle yards are no man's land.
This is lovely. So this hasn't been seen in a very long time.
No, this is probably the first time it's been seen operating since probably the 1980s.
Gosh.
So, okay. So Ross here and Steve have spent about, 2 days, 2-3 days, basically. Yeah, about 2 days.
Oh, Ross and Steve, well done.
Getting this back up and running with, you know, the family giving us their blessing to do it.
I'm told there's an engine I would like down here. I've been told there's an engine called Tim.
There is an engine called Tim.
It doesn't appear in the books, but apparently exists in real life. Look at that. I take my pocket.
So yeah, because the Mid-Sodal Railway was only in one book. It never really got much expansion because it was shown right at the end of its life, where the engines had been sold on.
Of course.
But Tim, the layout set earlier than that, so Tim is here, and we've got Tim with Tim.
Can we get a camera look at? Oh, sorry, look, just because my mum's watching this. She's watching this. Well, look, look, mum, look. It's Tim. It's me. Right, anyway, that's a lovely thing. So if you're watching this, anyone at Mattel, and you want to get another book or two out of it, Tim, the character, is up for that one. Thank you very much.
Tim the Tram Engine.
Thank you. Tim the Tram Engine. Lovely stuff. Now, talking of Mattel, the stuff that they've brought along, the team from Mattel has very generously and very kindly spent time and effort in going through the archives of the things that they have got and they have accessioned of the original collection. And this is the original artwork.
All the original artwork.
This is astonishing. This has rarely been seen in public before, right?
As far as I am aware, this is the first time they've ever been shown in the UK.
Good grief.
They've been shown in Japan, because there's quite a following over there. But, yeah, as far as we're aware, this is the first time in the UK these have been out on display.
Also, I mean, again, these are images from my childhood. God, good grief.
It's all recognisably Talyllyn as
Isn't
well.
It? It's so lovely. And look, that's the picture.
Well, there's Talyllyn.
Yeah, Talyllyn. What a lovely, lovely thing. What a lovely thing indeed.
And here's, you've got quarry siding, as on the Talyllyn in the 1960s. So there we are. That was in one of the books.
And we've got here, look, we've got letters.
Oh, no, not letters.
What's this?
So that is one of the very first handwritten drafts for the story Edward, Gordon and Henry.
That's
so this is pre-publication. It was one of the stories from the first book, the last story in the first book, Three Railway Engines, and that's one of the original handwritten manuscripts of the story.
And if I'm not mistaken, this is very interesting. This little scrap of paper here.
One of the first drawings of Henry, by Wilbert.
That is extraordinary. And over there, is that Edward?
No, that's Henry being painted blue.
Henry, of course. Before he got his colour changed.
Yes.
Look at that. Oh, this is terrific. Well, this is remarkable. I look up here. A 1953 sketch. We've mentioned this. We've actually got this hand-drawn version.
Yeah, so it's around 1953.
And what I like, though, there's that version. But look at this one.
So
it's got all the lines that were supposed to be built, but never got.
Yeah, so that's... For anyone who's up on the law, the Sodor and Mainland Railway originally wanted to take the main line over there and over the estuary rather than the way it ended up being. And it shows the original way they were going to cut the tunnel through the Ballyhoo Ridge. So there's a lot of neat proposal stuff on here that, you know, he's talked about in his lecture notes and other bits, but it's never quite made it into a published book. So it's quite a contrast between early days and when he was really in the deep end.
Absolutely. Now, Luke, I think we'll go outside again now, I think, and then just talk briefly about the stuff, because the room is filling up a little bit now. I'm just giving everyone
else a chance
to see the stuff. So, good thing on. I'll go outside, go to the museum. Give us a moment.
Right.
So we're going to set up to you, gentlemen. Good to see you. Thank you so much.
Right, keep going. So, I'm going to bring this out actually as well, because I'm going to bring this outside. We're going to talk about outside out here.
Oh, sorry.
Talyllyn stalwarts there. Can we go and stand over here actually? Sorry, chaps, can come stand over here. Just stand over. Because now when the train has gone, we've got Rinius has disappeared off up the valley, up Scullowy Valley.
Oh, yes.
Up to the waterfall halts and beyond. But it's interesting, I was looking here, this book, Dinah Ross, a different Dinah Ross, not She of the Supremes. This is a lovely little book that I'm very familiar with. Written at not a dissimilar time to Awdry's stuff. But, you know, little engines with faces, right? And little engines with faces have become very, very popular. This is, it's a gorgeous book. If you ever get a chance to see this, the scans on the internet of it, it's quite hard to actually get a copy of it, on a real one. These are generally charming little books. And there are elements of Thomas within this. You know, there are elements also Sammy the Shunter as well.
Oh yes.
So Thomas is not the only
buffer hands.
Yeah, Thomas is friends. Not the engines, but Awdry, of course, was one of many great storytellers. What do you think Audrey's legacy is?
I think it's one of the things I think is, you know, inspiring the next generation to get interested in railways and steam railways and getting involved with them, keeping the preservation movement going. You know, we can't remember, my generation and, you know, slightly younger, we can't remember steam on the main line. We've only had the heritage railways. And to have such a popular, you know, thing such as Thomas the Tank Engine, which you have in the forefront, steam engines.
Yeah.
And they're great.
Well,
it gets the hooking young.
I mean, it isn't just steam engines, it's the whole thing together. Actually,
yeah.
The thing that I think that I get from the Thomas stories is the railway family, I suppose.
Yes.
You're working together. As you come to the Talyllyn Railway, you can always be sure you're part of a railway family, right?
Absolutely. You come down for volunteering or anything, lots of friendly waves, lots of smiles, everyone knows you in the nice way.
Yes.
Yeah. It's always so welcoming, and it is such a lovely place to come down and be a part of.
Yeah.
You know,
there's always a cup of tea or a pint of beer available after you finish your duties on the TR.
Many pints today.
Yeah, many pints at the beer festival. So, thank you for watching this also sort of grand tour of Awdry's Extravaganza. Luke, well done for organising this.
Thank you very much.
Stuart, thank you very much for putting it all on. Thank you to all the volunteers and staff for working so particularly very hard this weekend to make it all work. And thank you for watching. Do come to the TR when you possibly can. And I do hope you get a chance to do this again in the future.
Absolutely.
Thank you very
much. Thank you so much. Here I am, every day.